Hello, I'm Locke Meredith with Legal Lines. I'd like to ask you to join us on today's show. We have on the show Sharon Broom. She is the Speaker Pro Tem in the Louisiana House of Representatives, second in control in the leadership. She's going to talk to us about her new role. She's been there for 13 years and the core issues that's facing the state and the new governor. So join us on the next Legal Lines. Welcome to Legal Lines. I'm Locke Meredith. I'm very pleased to have on the show Sharon Weston Broom. Ms. Broom is a Louisiana state representative. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Great to be here, Locke.
Not only are you a state representative, but you're pro tem. Explain what that means.
Well, Speaker pro tem, or Speaker pro tempore of the House of Representatives, means that I have the second leadership spot. Of course, the Speaker is the head honcho there in the legislature, in the House, rather. And I am right under him. It means that he makes a lot of the decisions. We share in some of those decisions together. When he's not presiding, I'm presiding. And it's
big
a very
job.
Yeah, it's a big job. You have 105 members, 104 other members in the legislature in the House. And so dealing with those individuals, my colleagues, on a regular basis, as it relates to policy issues, as it relates to just housekeeping measures, keeps me pretty busy.
How did you get to be Speaker Pro Tem? Give me a little personal information on it.
Well, I guess I could start in my journey, my political journey, because I think it all led up to me becoming Speaker Pro Tem of the House. I started in politics in 1988.
Now, where'd you go to college?
I went to college at the University of Wisconsin, La Crosse. Some people may remember that's where the Saints used to train a long, long time ago.
How in the world did you get here?
Well, that's another story, too. Maybe I should start back a little farther than that. I came to Louisiana in 1979. My father was born and raised in a little town called Ethel, Louisiana.
Oh, yeah.
People who know about Zachary and up that way know about Ethel. Well, when he was a young man, he moved to Chicago, met my mom, they got married. I came, was the only child from their marriage. And so after being in Chicago for so many years, my father just really got tired of the cold weather. Now, this is another significant issue, I think, Locke. My parents, my mother was 44 years old when I was born.
Really?
And my father was 53.
Wow.
So
that,
yeah, so that means that, you know, they were pretty elderly. We were a very, very close-knit family. So my father, you can understand, the older he got tired of the cold weather and decided, I want to go back home. I want to go to a warmer climate, so let's move to Louisiana. Well, of course, I had been to Louisiana because we had relatives here and visited when I was a little girl growing up. But never did I think that I would be living in Baton Rouge, Louisiana after growing up in Chicago. So we moved the family here. My father did.
That was a shock.
It was in 1979. Now, I have to be honest with you. I had just graduated from college from the University of Wisconsin, La Crosse. Yeah, I was about
19,
20.
Yeah.
So at that time, I told my parents, I said, look, I'm going to help you all make the transition to Baton Rouge, and then I'm going back to Chicago.
I'm out of here.
But as it turned out, when we moved to Louisiana, it was one of the greatest experiences of my life.
Why?
I mean, well, because it was such a contrast between Chicago and Louisiana.
Let me tell you something. I just got back from New York, and
yeah, it's a big difference.
I want to live here forever.
Yeah. And when I came to Baton Rouge, everybody was so warm. Everybody was so friendly. I mean, people would speak to you as you would go down the street. That was unheard of in Chicago.
It doesn't
happen in a big city. You do that in a big city, people think something's wrong with you. So that was just really, really a delight for me. And I just fell in love with Baton Rouge and with the people here. And decided
so
I wanted to make it my home. I started looking for jobs and ended up working as an administrative assistant to someone over a political action committee at the Louisiana Association of Business and Industry at
that
time.
So immediately went into politics.
Well, it was not immediate. I dabbled in a lot of things. My background was in communications. So my ultimate goal was to get involved in radio and television, and I did have some experience
there. Done the same
thing?
Yeah,
exactly. And so I dabbled in television a little bit, started there at LABI, then went to grad school.
Really? Because Lobby is conservative?
Yeah. But I...
The gentleman
there by the name of Dick Schneider gave me my first job when I came to Baton Rouge, and I'll never forget that, and I'm totally indebted to him for that. But afterwards, I went to graduate school in 1982 at Regent University in Virginia Beach, stayed there for 2 years, got my master's degree in communication, came back to Baton Rouge, and started working in television and doing some radio.
I remember seeing you.
And eventually in 1988 decided that I wanted to get involved and make a difference in my community in a stronger way. And became, ran for the city council in Baton Rouge. So that was really the start of my political journey. Stayed on the city council for 3 years, then ran for...
It's a tough job, isn't it?
Yeah, but it's good training ground. I tell people that all the time. Being on the city council is good training ground because you deal with individuals' everyday issues. I mean, street,
it's
drainage...
Pretty much the same stuff over and
housing
over.
Housing issues... You know, with garbage issues, so it really gives you an opportunity to appreciate what the definition of public servant
really
means.
It is a thankless job. I don't think folks have really. Most folks don't understand how giving it is. How giving you have to be to do that.
Yeah, so it was good training ground for me. And in 1991. After redistricting, there was an open seat, a seat created, House District 29, which encompassed part of my council district. And so I decided, after much prayerful consideration, that I would run for that seat. And so now I'm serving my fourth term.
Which so how long? 8 years now?
No.
No,
13.
Term. 13.
This is my,
years.
Yeah, this is my, and I will complete 16 years after. This term, and so
are you affected by the term limits?
I certainly am affected by term limits. This is my last term.
Yeah, did that make you happy or sad?
Well, I have mixed emotions. I think that there are some advantages and disadvantages to term limits. First of all, I think that the process of democracy works, and that if there are people in office, elected office, who are not living up to the expectations of their constituents.
Ultimate term limit is...
Yeah, at the voting booth.
That's right.
You know, and it happens all the time. So I think that's a very effective process. I think we lose a lot of institutional knowledge when we have a mass exodus of a group of people who've been there over years.
Jay Darden and I were just talking about how it takes years to become acclimated to the system and who you're going to trust when they tell you something and who doesn't quite tell it the right way.
Absolutely. And then I think that it has an impact on seniority. For example, it takes you, just as you said, a while to even get acclimated and to work your way into leadership positions. I have been very fortunate that in my second term in office, I became a chairman of a committee. Now, my first term in office, I eventually moved to the Appropriations Committee, which was a key slot. And then after that, had an opportunity to move to a leadership position as a chair of a committee.
Well, let's talk about the committees and basically what you're doing up there on the next segment. This is Locke Meredith. We're Sharon Weston Broome. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Legal Lines. I'm Locke Meredith. I'm very pleased to have Sharon Weston Broome. She is a Louisiana House of Representatives in Louisiana House of Representatives and Speaker Pro Tem. Again, thank you very much for being on the show.
Great to be here.
Let's talk about basically the committees that you're chairing or that you're involved in, because I assume those are the areas that you have particular interest in.
Well, certainly as I started out as a chairman in my second term, I chaired the House Committee on Municipal, Parochial, and Cultural Affairs. And at that time, I think the Speaker of the House, Hunt Downer, selected me for that role because of my background in local government. But it really broadened my insight regarding the state of Louisiana, especially not only as it relates to local issues, but as it relates to cultural issues as well, because in that role, we were directly connected with the Department of Culture, Recreation, and Tourism, which the Lieutenant Governor had.
Right. Seems to handle a lot of stuff.
Yeah, and so I found out about the wonderful treasures here in Louisiana, the cultural treasures, the state parks, travel to practice. practically every state park in Louisiana. And because my committee had oversight over cultural recreation, we learned so much about what Louisiana has to offer.
Well, and that's a question I was asking Jay Darden earlier. I'm concerned that the plants are going to be moving out because natural gas is so high and getting higher that that aspect of our economy is going to go down. And I'm wondering, where are we focusing our attention to draw in additional revenue? And I assume that's one of them, exactly what you're talking about.
Certainly tourism, and certainly one area that I know there is a movement to tap into more is even the entertainment and film industry.
And that seems to be happening a little
bit. It is. I've communicated with with Mark Smith, who works with the Film Commission and Film Office here for the state of Louisiana. And we've been getting a number of requests and inquiries into films being done here in Louisiana. And we've had a number that have been produced here in Louisiana.
How do you attract those folks? Do you offer them incentives with
tax credits
and stuff like that?
Tax credits, but we also have to build an infrastructure, you know, as well. We're looking into possibly the need for, there is a need for a sound stage, a sound studio to accommodate. I think we have one already in the New Orleans area, but we need more. We also need to, and this is where the whole education component comes in, we need to educate people who can fill slots in that industry. So I think once we start building towards that, we'll see even more movement as it relates to the film industry. But that's something that I think is will be a very big breakthrough for us economically that's on the horizon.
What other committees are you
Well, now that I am Speaker Pro Tem.
Imagine anything you want, huh?
Well, actually, I serve as an ex officio member of every committee, but I have been assigned and have requested to sit on the House Committee on Health and Welfare.
All right, let's talk about that. What does that encompass?
Well, as you know, Locke, when the governor came in office, one of her big initiatives is health care, certainly.
And scary time right now.
Yeah.
I mean, nobody can afford health insurance.
I tell you, that's a whole issue we could talk about for hours.
I mean, something's got to be done.
Absolutely. And as a result, the governor held a health care summit, which I'm sure you remember. And there was so much information, a deluge of information that came from national healthcare experts, from people here in our state. But what I think happened there was certainly a coming together and a bond of people from all facets of healthcare, advocates, providers, et cetera, who came together with a commitment to try to come up with a solution. Now, as you can imagine, we could not come up with a solution in a two-day healthcare summit.
It's a big problem.
But we did get a lot of information to help us move towards where we need to be as a state in healthcare. And subsequent to that, the governor now has a healthcare committee or a commission that will look at some of the issues, the high-profile issues that emerge from that conference, and focus on moving them forward in terms of shaping policy, healthcare policy in the future.
As I understand it, the charity system, we're at a point now where you either have to fix old rundown facilities or build new facilities or try and use existing private facilities in a more, I guess, charities way, but they'll obviously be compensated.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because that has been a number one concern of mine since I've been a state representative, and that is in our area here in Baton Rouge, Earl K. Long Hospital. Earl K. Long Hospital.
How old is Earl K. Long?
Oh, I can't
must
tell
be
you
75
how
old.
It's antiquated. I can tell you that. And I know firsthand about the hospital. I've been there on a number of occasions, not only as a legislator, but with family members. And the hospital is located a block from my district office, so I can actually, and I have walked from my district office around to Earl K. Long Hospital. But the greater issue is that long ago, when the hospital was generating funds, that money went into the general fund instead of being put back into.
So now it's broke.
Yeah. So now the hospital, I think everyone is in agreement that hospital is not fit for inpatient services, for inpatient care. And so we have to move in another direction, and we've been trying to do that for a number of years now. Well, I am very optimistic, and I think that we're right on the breakthrough of having a new facility possibly in the near future. You know, it takes a long time to get the financing in place.
Are there federal funds available for that?
There are some federal funds available, but the state is going to have to put up a significant amount of money to make this happen. And there's also movement towards clinics in the area. You know, most of the people who come to Earl K. Long Hospital come for primary care needs.
So they don't need the emergency room?
The emergency room provides what is needed in terms of a primary care physician. So if we can first plug the hole
right
with that primary care by perhaps having clinics throughout our community, that will serve a very significant need. But we also need to provide a community hospital. Going away from the charity mindset, we have to have a community hospital that will service not only the indigent, but the working class and those from all over who would like to come to this hospital, because one of the advantages is that it is a teaching and research hospital as well, so that provides a...
And we got Pennington here. You would think it'd
exactly
be a good affiliation.
Exactly.
Sounds like kind of the what I'm hearing is that we're talking about constructing perhaps a new type of hospital, but also maybe combining, maybe both, build some new structures, but also use the private system a little bit in solving the problem?
I think it has to eventually be that type of combination. I can't tell you exactly what the finished product will be, but I can tell you that I have already requested in the appropriation and the capital outlay process over $1 million for planning for this new hospital. So I believe that eventually we will see the manifestation of it.
That's good news. Let's talk about the next big issues on the next segment. This is Locke Meredith with Legal Lines, and Sharon Weston Broom will be right back. Welcome back to Legal Lines. I'm Locke Meredith with State Representative Sharon Weston Broom. Sharon, again, thanks for being on the show. We were talking about the various committees, and as Speaker Pro Tem, you basically own all of them if you want to be. We were talking about the hospital situation. What other big issues do you see facing the state right now that you're involved with?
Well, when you mentioned the hospital issue, I thought about a bill that I had this session that we've turned into a study, and that is called The Money Follows the Individual. That's the title of the bill. But basically, it is moving away from institutionalized care and allowing those individuals with disabilities who want to move towards more independent lifestyles to have that opportunity by having the Medicaid funding follow them.
That's very interesting.
It, you know, it's a big issue, and it's going to take a lot to get where we need to be, because there's so many different components. You know, I've had people come and talk to me who were in have children in developmental centers, and I understand that they have children who have severe disabilities and don't feel like they should be moved, and that's understandable, and they're concerned about how having this money taken away from perhaps those individuals who leave that system will impact the ability of that system to survive, that developmental disability center to survive. That's a concern, of
course. I tell you, that whole area is really kind of personally important to us.
Really?
We have a family member who has some mental and emotional problems, serious problems. 80-year-old parents can't take care of him anymore. And so you're trying to figure out what is available to help
right
the families deal with folks like that or disabilities, because unless you deal with it, you really don't understand how traumatic it is.
So we're going to work real hard to see if we can bring all the interested parties to the table and come up with some policy that will help us move towards more progressive health care for those individuals with disabilities.
Any discussions of facilities, the construction of facilities that deal with folks with the mental and emotional issues? Because it's hard to find a place for someone to stay. You don't want to stick them in a nursing home. 80-plus-year-old parents can't take care of them. It's a tough scenario.
Yeah, there has not been any discussion as it relates to new buildings, but certainly the issue is being discussed. Also, you know, when we talk about families, another prevalent issue, Locke, is that Louisiana is fourth in the nation when it comes to grandparents who are raising their grandchildren. Now, that's
really?
It's for a variety of issues, you know, because of the challenges that we're facing in society, broken homes, substance abuse. You name it. And so many of these children are left with the option of going into foster care sometime,
which you don't want,
or being put at the doorstep of a grandparent. And many of these grandparents have assumed responsibility for their grandchildren, thank God.
Right.
And so they stay connected to their family. But as you can imagine, grandparents are going into a season of their life where they're retired. They're on a fixed income, most of them. Some of them live in smaller housing units. And so they have to
regear
to raise a child or children.
And that you want those children to be raised by someone who loves them and cares about them, is connected to them, than someone who doesn't, because they're going to be a better citizen.
Absolutely.
And more productive.
Absolutely. So what we've done, I went to a meeting years ago with grandparents raising grandchildren and became aware of this issue, connected to it. I guess their issue just tugged on my heart, and so I became one of their major advocates at the state legislature. And we've been very fortunate to get a number of pieces of legislation passed that help break through a number of the barriers that they face.
What does it do? What does it help?
Well, one of the most significant pieces of legislation that we passed was the Grandparent Subsidy Program, which allows a $200 plus subsidy for those grandparents who qualify to help take care of their grandchildren. And we enlarged that to the kinship care subsidy program. So now those beyond the relationship of grandparent who have custody of
children,
they can get that subsidy,
right,
as well. So
that
received national recognition.
$200 isn't a whole lot of money.
It's not, but you know what? Every little bit helps
right.
when you're in a situation like that. So we've tried to remove some of the educational barriers in terms of legal barriers that might
exist. I would imagine that's cheaper than sending them to foster care.
Oh, absolutely.
So why not encourage that?
Absolutely, absolutely. It is it's much more cost effective. So that's been an issue that's been real dear to my heart that I've been working on. And so every year we revisit the grandparents and find out if there is anything that we need to do to help further advance their agenda and work towards that. Another consumer-oriented issue that I've been working on is predatory lending.
Now, what is that? Describe
predatory,
that for me.
Predatory lending has to do primarily in the housing industry, where individuals are often encouraged to get a second mortgage from different companies and companies that
debt
may not be...
consolidation kind
yes,
of stuff.
Yes, exactly. And there's oftentimes fine print that's involved, and you find that people don't realize that if they miss a payment that their house can be...
Basically probably going from unsecured debt to debt that's secured by a mortgage on their house that they can yank from them.
Right, exactly. And people don't realize this, then they're often taken advantage of, and many of the areas, certain areas are targeted for predatory lending. So I have authored a resolution this session which will create the Predatory Lending Task Force and hopefully bring all parties from both the mortgage lending and banking community to those individuals from the consumer point of view and advocates who will come together from the housing industry and talk about how we can come up with some effective legislation which will address this issue.
Is it not federally regulated at all?
No, it's not at this
really?
Present time. It's
interesting.
Not, yeah.
What other committees are you involved in that are close to your heart?
Well, I tell you, marriage and family issues are very dear to my heart. In fact, I am the chairman of the Governor's Commission on Marriage and Family. And what we try to do there is strengthen two-parent families, you know, the husband and the wife, because we have found out and statistical data shows, sociologists have reiterated and confirmed time and time again that those children who have the opportunity and are blessed to be in a two-parent family certainly have more success in life. Now, that is certainly not to condemn single mothers or single parents, because there are a lot of them doing a yeoman's job of raising their children. But we look at issues that perhaps we as a state are causing as barriers to families coming together and being strengthened and working to give educational opportunities for parents and counseling strengthen opportunities to strengthen the family.
Shannon, thank you so much for
thank
being
you.
On the show. We're glad
it's
you're
been
up
a
there
pleasure.
In the leadership, and we'll have you on again
okay.
if you would
look forward
it.
To it.
This is Lock Meadows with Legal Lines, and we'll see you next time.